All right, Crystal, what's on your radar?
Well, Donald Trump is an aberration, a break from American traditions and history, a singular threat taking the country over the brink. In order to be a Democrat in good standing these days, that is the doctrine that you must absolutely accept. All sorts of other transgressions, past sins, warmongering, deficit hawkery, destructive abuses of power, and certainly shameless self-promotion, that can be all be forgiven so long as you are on board with that particular view of Donald Trump. It's a central theory binding together the never-Trump Republican with the resistance Democrat. It's the central programming dictate of MSNBC, CNN, and basically every other non-Fox News source. On Fox, of course, the programming is flipped, and it's the Democrats who are the aberrant party destroying the nation. Trump as unique evil and dramatic departure from American life is the central argument of Biden's Restore the Soul of the Nation messaging and really his entire largely policy-free campaign. Watching Trump's obnoxious behavior at this week's debate, I can't blame you for wanting to believe that Trump is some horrid foreign virus injected into the American bloodstream when we didn't have the proper immunities built up. But this view of him is totally and utterly incorrect. In fact, there is nothing and no one more American than Donald Trump. He is the inevitable end result of the society that we have jointly created here, a grotesque eruption of the fetid swamps of celebrity and consumerism, a hometown creation of a nation that's been addicted to cheap, schlocky crap, had our brains addled by the substance-free titillation that passes for entertainment, our bodies made thick and lazy by the fat and sugar big food engineers to trigger us to binge. In other words, our nation has fully succumb to late-stage capitalism. And that is exactly the well from which Donald Trump springs. He is the human embodiment of late-stage capitalism. He's not cut from the cloth of dictators, strongmen, and fascists like Hitler, Mussolini, or even Viktor Orban or Bolsonaro. He's cut from the cloth of Wendy's, get-rich-quick schemes, and 90s episodes of Cops. Now, that's not to say he's not dangerous, mind you. Late-stage capitalism is quietly murdering Americans every single day. It's killing us through a food system built around addiction and binging rather than nourishment, a healthcare system designed to make you a good customer with lucrative chronic conditions, a consumer culture meant to create ever more insecurities rather than satisfy your needs. The New York Times investigation into Trump's finances really makes all of this quite plain. It didn't reveal, as many had posited, connections to Russian oligarchs that would have fed the fantasy that Trump is a foreign-controlled agent. It would ultimately be very comforting to think that our national nightmare was created by some evildoer in a foreign land. Instead, it showed that his web of financiers was much closer to home. He was propped up and financed by American capitalists and consumers. As the Times put it, he slapped his name on everything from steaks and vodka to a board game and cologne. He signed a licensing deal with the Serta mattress company that eventually netted him more than $15 million. Another $15 million would pour in from Trump neckties, shirts, and underwear by clothiers like Phillips Van Heusen. Warner Music paid $100,000 to feature Mr. Trump in a collection of cell phone ringtones. Unilever, which was looking to promote a new version of its all-brand laundry detergent, concocted an entire multi-platform marketing campaign around Mr. Trump. Trump's famous amorality is also a deeply American creation. We have long ago abandoned any pretense that our society should be structured around a set of common values or, God forbid, the good of the people. No, we're a nation that lionizes the bankers who foreclose on your home, the moguls who pioneer new ways to crush the bodies and the spirits of workers, the drug makers who make billions off of addicting and murdering our brothers and sisters. Our best and brightest are expected to graduate and work at a place like J.P. Morgan Chase, which was just fined for running a near-decade-long criminal financial scheme to rig metals markets, or, like Pete Buttigieg, went to work for McKinsey fixing bread prices. Then the pundits expected to land when they, "How dare you, sir, Donald Trump," or expect voters to judge him based on some moral compass. What moral compass? Our entire society is set up to convince you that the rich deserve their wealth, that GDP growth is more important than jobs and vitality in your town, that the stock market is somehow real in any meaningful way. Any morals are selectively applied and only to the poor and to the working class, not to rich guys like Trump. The rules never apply to him, so why should they now? His primary political innovation was to understand the presidential race not as a contest of competing values and ideas, but as a ratings-driven spectacle, one in which you are ultimately protected from your adversaries by the fact that they are also on the take, profiting handsomely off the entire show. In that, he is a true pioneer, but one who is just continuing the work of the past set down by so many before him, so many greed-is-good predators that came to mark that path. Extending the soulless absurdity and debasement of late late-stage capitalism all the way into the White House. Joe Biden may beat him, but there will be no going back because Trump has revealed the all-American nature of our rotten core. And I think, Sagar, the failure to understand what really drives Trump is part of why Democrats have been so ineffective and the media has been so ineffective in countering him this whole time.
Yeah, I think that's right. And one of the things that I found hilarious about Trump is he just does what they all do, except in a more crude fashion.
In a more brazen, outright way. And that's why they hate him so much.
I know, because he exposes them. The reason they hated him in the first place is because he was basically just doing what they all did, except he did it in a more flashy and gaudy fashion.
Yeah.
And they were like, well, this is just, you know, out of style. We don't put our names on the buildings that we depreciate and while we pay zero taxes.
Right. Yeah. Or like, you know, you think about their kids. So like the proper way to do corruption is the way Hunter did it.
Yes.
Right. It's not, you can never directly tie anything. It's all based on your name. You get to sit on the board. That's all on the up and up. But you actually put your kid in the White House and like make them an advisor and watch them ink business deals that directly benefit them because of their position in that White House. Like, that is that next step level of brazen that exposes really everyone and the corruption that they've been doing all the time.
This is with everything. I mean, so much of what they're like, oh, gosh, like, Trump is such a gauche man for doing X deal. And I'm like, you guys do the same thing. You guys are just, you know, you do it in a more classy way. Does that make it better? No. I mean, I would argue that's honestly kind of worse because it's beneath the surface. It's accepted and sanctioned by the media. It's made it so that it's normalized in our political culture. What they hate from him is he just took their norms and departed from it like one more standard deviation.
Right.
I mean, does that, like, who's the real criminal? I don't know.
Well, all of them, in my view. But, you know, and I don't think that there's any sort of turning back from that now that we have come to that final resting point. I see Donald Trump, like, there's this view of him, obviously, that is, I think, broadly accepted within the mainstream of the Democratic Party, the Joe Biden view that, like, this guy came out of nowhere and everything was great, and then here's this monster, and we just gotta get rid of him and we'll be back to normal. I think people need to really understand that that's a fantasy.
Yeah.
This guy comes directly out of our culture. Like, he is the spawn of this country. He is as American as anything else. And look, this is a complicated country. There are beautiful qualities. There are beautiful qualities that are represented in our people, in some of our great leaders currently and over time. And there are really ugly, pernicious qualities that manifest themselves in people and leaders and the appeal of those leaders like Donald Trump. But to pretend like he's some foreign agent, like, brought in, being puppet mastered by someone overseas, that's very comfortable for all of us because we don't have to actually reflect on, like, what kind of a society would create this person as our national leader. So that, to me, as we move into a potential Joe Biden era, I hope that that becomes increasingly clear to people that if you don't deal with the underlying rot that brought us to this place, you are just going to be doomed to repeat this cycle over and over and over again, and it's going to destroy the country.
I think we're going to have bifurcated politics. You're going to have a bunch of the foolish elites here in D.C. who are basically playing Versailles, you know, palace games like they were in the 1700s. And you're going to have, you know, undercurrents bubbling all across the country. And you're going to have smart politicians who understood the core innovation of what Trump did. I think personally, the person who best understands this is AOC. I think, you know, the way that she plays the media, the way that she has a brand in and of herself, frankly, in the many ways that she likes to provoke Fox and others, she knows exactly what she's doing.
If anybody thinks
that she's just like a naive, you know, former bartender or whatever, I see the game. I think it's smart, which is how to be provocative, how to get headlines, how to make people defend something that you want them to defend and then attack it in order for going after you. This is a very smart innovation played by Trump. It's new media politics. It's becoming a celebrity and building a brand and creating like a virtual reality around yourself that millions can then inhabit. And I think that that is the future of America much more than anybody here wants to admit. I'm here for it. I think it's good. Screw these people. I hate the people who created these norms and so many of the other things. I want to see us depart from that.
Yeah, I guess I would say I am waiting to see how it all unfolds. I think we're on the precipice of, like, potentially, you know, a just breakdown, honestly, in society. I mean, I think we're both very concerned about Election Day and how it all goes. But there's also a potential that because we've had this kind of break that we could forge something new and fundamentally better for the American people. And I am very hopeful for that possibility, even though I'm not sure if it is the most likely outcome.
Yeah, I don't know. But people have bet against America every time since 1780, and it generally works out. So I think we're good.
All right, Sagar, looking forward to your radar. That's next.